in our city has instead become a gauntlet of unprecedented challenges that strike at the very sense of community. To answer that question will take courage, but when we answer it, we discover something incredible. We discover that we are not defeated, that we will go on, that we will endure, that this city will persist, that we are resilient, and that so long as we have life left in us, we will not turn away from the one thing that is asked of all those who choose to live in a community, that we care for one another. Last night, IMPD released the names of 8 people taken from us too soon. Some were grandparents, some had not yet turned 20 years old. Some grew up here, some had chosen Indianapolis as their home. 4 of them were members of our local Sikh community. 1 even worked for the city in a park just like this one, a lifeguard in a neighborhood pool. And all of them, they worked together. Even though we may not have known them, we do love them. We do miss them, and in their name, we continue on. And we can still honor their memory. How? By choosing to be a light in the darkness. By choosing love over fear. By doing that one thing we must all do when we live in a community. Caring for one another. And in so doing, let us lift up our voices this evening to a nation that is watching, to a nation that is hurting, and offer a prayer. Holy Spirit, Advocate, Comforter, be unmistakably present as the source of healing, hope, strength, and compassion. May your light shine brighter than the chaos that grips us. May the water of life flow through the parched places in our world and in our lives. May the love of God have the resounding last life-giving word, and may we amplify that word in our actions and in our world. Indeed, amen and amen. And now I'd like to introduce my friend, the congressman from Indiana's 7th district, Andre Carson.
Thank you, Mayor. Pardon my attire. To Renee Pack, thank you so much, and to your husband and family, to my fellow Hoosiers. We've come together today in a moment of unspeakable tragedy for our community. We've lost 8 of our neighbors to a senseless act of violence. We still don't know how many people were injured or wounded, and we must support their recovery and healing too. I want to thank the family, the friends, and the loved ones who showed up today. You know, as we grieve together, we send our deepest sympathies to everyone affected. Our office is ready to help in any way we can, and the mayor has done a phenomenal job as a leader, as a friend, and a public servant. I also want to acknowledge the Sikh community, which has suffered a particularly tragic loss. In addition, I want to thank the first responders who are bravely taking care of the victims. There's a lot we don't know yet about this particular shooting. I will continue working with our mayor and local authorities to get all the information, but here's what I do know. This is not the first time that Hoosiers have felt this intense grief and pain. It's not even, unfortunately, the first mass shooting in our community. I also know that the suspected shooter should never have had access to a deadly weapon. The loss of life here in Indianapolis is real. It's real in Boulder. It's real in Atlanta and in countless other communities that are part of a nationwide epidemic of gun violence. We can't continue living with the constant threat of gun violence everywhere we go, in our workplaces, our schools, our places of worship, and everywhere else. It's not normal. It will never be normal. Choosing not to take action is an insult to Hoosiers, the ones we lost, and every other victim of gun violence. We've long supported the effort to pass common sense gun safety reforms, and we won't rest until they become law. That includes getting assault weapons out of civilian hands. It's a moral imperative. Ensuring this change should not be a political or divisive or bipartisan issue. Americans of every background have felt the pain of the loss due to gun violence. We have to put aside our differences and work together to stop this common threat. We can do it. We must do it. We must honor those we've lost with action to save lives in the future. Let's turn this tragedy into a catalyst for change and create safer communities for all Americans. At this point, I want to introduce a fellow American, a brave American. He is our police chief. It's a thankless job, but I commend him for the sacrifices that he makes, the sleepless nights, and his leadership of leading our Metro Police Department, Chief Randall Taylor.
I'm going to keep my comments brief, but let me share with you the things I saw over these last few hours, 24 hours or so. When I first got the page that we had a mass shooting at FedEx, I started receiving phone calls, mostly from my staff, updating me on what was going on. And when I got out to the facility, the first thing I noticed was first responders doing the incredible job that they do, not only the men and women of the IMPD, although they were indeed outstanding, but also medical personnel. And then I saw how local hotels took care of those families. And then later that morning, I met the families. And I was immediately impressed with their strength. Now, if you ask them, they may say they didn't show any strength. They may have even felt weak. But they were strong, and they were unified together in a room as they awaited the word on their loved ones. In times like this, I think I'm reminded mostly of a scripture, 1 Corinthians 10. It talks about God's willingness to not allow us to deal with more than we can bear. Now, that scripture, it's talking about temptations, but I think it applies here because these families could, of course, be tempted to be angry, and that would be understandable. These families could feel like they can't go on. That, too, is understandable. But, you know, in that passage of scripture, God says, basically, you can handle this. That may not seem that way right now. But I think if those families look out and see all the support they have in just this group, I think God allows them to get the vision that you can handle this and you're going to have help. You're going to have communities, people that you don't even know that are praying about you. I hope they understand that. I will pray with them as well. This is not something they'll ever forget. It's nothing that they're going to get past all that quickly. But I'm hopeful that they remember the good times they had with their loved ones. Hopefully they'll remember the way IMPD and others tried to take care of them. I believe at some point they will come out of this. They'll still be mournful, but they will go on, and we're going to be right there to help them out wherever we can. I do want to thank the community. I've received messages, and I'm not the victim, right? I'm not a family of the victim, but so many people have contacted me and saying our prayers are with us, with the IMPD and those families, from law enforcement and other groups all over the United States. Indianapolis is strong. We are a great community, and we take care of our own. And that's what we'll continue to do as we wrap our arms around these families. May God bless, and may God strengthen.
Thank you so much, Chief. At this time, we're going to have our president of the Indianapolis City Council, Bob Ossoli, share his thoughts.
Let me start by thanking those who were on the scene immediately Thursday night and Friday morning, our first responders and law enforcement. And I thank them for putting their lives on the line, for caring for those who were in pain, and doing all that they could to rectify what they saw. Just over 2 hours ago, I was just reflecting, I was with my family, and we were celebrating a birthday, my mother's birthday. My mother's 97th birthday. And what I was thinking about just now is that should be the expectation of everyone who is standing here today, that they can live a life that'll get them to 100. That should be our expectation. I'm not worried about if they go to the supermarket, or if they go to work, or they go to the park, or they go to the salon, that they could be cut down. What I do believe we need to have is that adult discussion. Without rancor, but with facts, that address gun violence. Because we should not be standing here again. And I just ask, as we go home tonight, if we think about that, and all of us who have positions and levels of authority that we have those discussions and we take those necessary actions so that we are not standing here again. And for everyone who's standing right now, I would ask as you go home that you remember those that were lost and the families, and that you put your arms around those who are around you and those that you know are hurting. But I thank you all for coming out, and again, I thank our responders and law enforcement and those who have shown care and concern for those who have lost family and friends. Thank you.
We want to thank all of our elected officials for coming out tonight and sharing and giving their condolences to the friends and families of our neighbors that were so tragically killed on Thursday night. I have a young woman that I hadn't met before tonight, but I just wanted her to come forward and cry to represent the Sikh community.
Good afternoon, everybody, and to my Sikh Sangat over here, Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, Vaheguru Ji Ki Fateh. My name is Asis Kaur, and tonight I was asked to speak on behalf of the beautiful families of Amarjeet Kaur Sekho and Jasvinder Kaur. I'm also here on behalf of the Sikh Coalition. I want to thank everyone from across the community, Sikh and non-Sikh, directly connected to this tragedy or not, for coming out to this vigil tonight. In these moments of mourning, it is togetherness and unity that sustain us and prepare us for the long haul of physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual healing. Yet, we also gather tonight because horrific events like Thursday's shooting call us to action. The ever-present hate and violence in our society, including these kinds of attacks, which we suffer day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, are a threat to all of us. We must support one another, not just in grief, but in calling our policymakers and elected officials to make meaningful change. The time to act is not later, but now. We are far too many tragedies too late in doing so. I ask all of you that you keep the families of those killed and those who are still recovering from their injuries in your prayers and in your hearts. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, we're going to have a candle lit to represent every one of our friends that were lost on Thursday. I have Samaria's friend, Ryan, here today. They grew up and were homeschooled together, and they were very, very close friends. So she is going to help us with lighting the candles. And if I could also have Counselor Evans assist, and also if I could have a family member assist. And you all will take the lighter, and as I call a name, please light one candle and then hand the lighter to the next person. And the first light is in honor of Matthew R. Alexander. The next light represents Samaria Blackwell. Our next light represents Jaws Bendor Core. And the next light is in honor of Amarjeet Kaur Jahal. The next light is in honor of Amarjeet Sikhan. Jaws Vinder Sikh is our next light. This young lady was only 19, as was Samaria. And I just want to know if her family is here, her friends are here. We're so sorry. God bless you all. Carly Smith is our next light. Are you mother? Are you mother?
No, I'm looking for her mother's ear, I believe. But I'm just a very good friend of Carly's family. Okay. I don't know if I can speak right now. I already spoke to the news, but.
Why don't we just wait just a minute, because I've got other family members.
Yes, thank you.
Amen. Our family members and friends are anxious to speak about their family members, and I certainly understand that. But in the interest of time, we're not going to be able to hear from everybody. At this time, if you have, and our last light, I'm sorry. A gentleman from Zionsville, Mr. John Weissert. Are they all lit? At this time, if you all have a lighter or one of our plastic candles, or if you just want to use your phone, would you please light them and raise them high as we honor these eight and also pray for the others that are injured and recovering. And if I could have Mrs. Mary Beth Kinner here to sing Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no last days to sing God's praise. That when we first begun,
thank you, ma'am. She came here from Lafayette to share that song with us. This concludes our ceremony for tonight. I thank you all. Oh, I did want to hear from our friend from FedEx Ground, a representative, please. I'm sorry. Go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hello, everybody. I'm Ryan Henry from FedEx Ground. And today we mourn the 8 FedEx team members that we lost. Our hearts go out to their families. And we also hold dear those who were wounded and all those who survived but were also victims of this heinous attack. Our top priority is that our team members are safe, and we're going to do everything we can to support them through this difficult time. As we mourn, it's important to recognize our team members here in Indianapolis for their bravery and their support that they've shown for one another. I've seen firsthand the heroic efforts of many of those involved, and the strength and love that they've shown for one another and for their families is truly awe-inspiring. It's hard to find the right words for moments like this. I found the best we can do is give each other strength and support, and that's what we'll do in the days and the weeks ahead. On behalf of the entire FedEx family, I'd like to thank all the first responders and the city of Indianapolis for the support you've given us over the last 48 hours. And for many of us, Indianapolis is home, and it's during tragic events like this that we all need to stay close to one another. We know we have a long road ahead of us, and it will take time to heal, and even longer for any form of normalcy. However, with all of you, we're committed to do whatever's necessary to come out of this stronger than before. And I know we will. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for that. I'd like to ask one thing as we depart from the park, is that we don't all go running to our cars to get away, but that you stop and say hello to somebody, that you give them a fist bump, that you tell them you care, especially our family members and friends of this mighty 8. Don't just leave them. Touch base with them on a personal level. I appreciate you all so much. Thanks for coming. Thanks to all the elected officials that are here. Thank you to our representatives from the C community. I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And thank all of you. And that concludes our ceremony.